very, very pregnant.
It's like they're moving slowly towards us, so let's wait to see if there's any youngsters in this herd. You can see her teats are actually even already swollen, so very likely to give birth within the next day or two. Nice bit of pawing of the ground, there we go. Nice little head rub and pawed the ground. I was wondering whether she's going to lie down or roll. I think she's just having a good scratch. Oh, are we going to be lucky enough? Well, Wildebeest got his nickname, the Wildebeest, because he filmed a live birth. Is Wilde looking at his second live birth today? Who knows? Trying to see if there are any babies amongst the others. But they're still a little bit far away, slowly moving towards us. Can't see any young ones. There is quite a high mortality rate. Lions and leopards are big fans of eating the baby wildebeest, and even hyenas as well. But it's going to be interesting to see what's going on. I'm not sure why that female's lying down. I'm moving the vehicle a little bit so we can see her a bit better. And she's not doing what wildebeest normally do. Could be cool weather, she's just lying down for a bit of rumination. There's a baby. Two babies. Oh, we're just going to stop here. We don't want to disturb them, but there are two babies. And while we sit with these wildly beasts, Matthew Thompson, who's a new viewer on YouTube, welcome, Matthew, is wondering what's the rarest animal I've ever seen. Well, let's think. On the live drives, it's not the rarest, but it's very rare to see on the live drives. It would be a serval. But in terms of the rarest animal I've ever seen, it's probably a menelistic leopard. So menelistic is the opposite of leucistic. So very black in coloration. So basically a black panther or a black leopard would probably be the rarest animal I've ever seen. There's a little baby. I wonder if it's the one who had the rude awakening to life within an hour of birth being bumped by a buffalo bull. So hopefully those babies move out towards us and we get a nice view of them. It's quite cloudy today and has been in the mornings, and ask me, who's on the Twitter sphere, would like to, or says it's a lot cloudier than Big Cat Week, and is that normal? During the summer months we do have overcast days. There's a lot more sort of moisture in the air and around, so we do have a little bit more cloud cover at this time of the year compared to the dry season. Move forward a little bit, those babies. Okay, let's have a look. The baby is just through there. Okay. Let's see. We can get a nice view of one of the little ones. So mothers with little babies a little bit less relaxed than the others, but there we go. There's another one just up ahead. Look how very different looking from the adults. Very pale. They, if you look carefully, their faces are quite similar, but the coloration, they'll only get darker as they get a bit older. But look how cute they are. So, Blue Gnu is named after the Twitter or handle is after the wildebeest. Paul Rizzo and Jessica on YouTube are all wondering how the world's having a drink. Blue wildebeest are pregnant for. And they're pregnant for 250 days, more or less. Now mate in April to early June and start birthing right now. Sometimes as early as mid-November, depending on the season. Let's try and move into a better spot again. But average gestation period of 250 days. And like impala, is that a big hole or a big stump?
Both.
Both? Okay, well, we're not going to try manhandle our way up that. Change the line of reverse slightly. With the new baby is a little bit nervous, so we don't want to push her too much, but it looks like she's going to move out to the open. So I think we're going to preempt them and try and get up ahead of them. So while we're doing that, a very good morning to Shannon in Ohio. Shannon would like to know, will the mother stop feeding before she gives birth? Generally, she will. She won't be actively feeding. I have seen wildebeest ruminate while giving birth, but only in the early stages, once the sort of labor is in heavy progress, they do even stop ruminating. I'm just trying to see they're moving out into a slightly more open area on the edge of Impala Plains. Baby pop out through here. So Roger says he's always loved wildebeest, but mostly because it's the most fun word to say. And if we speak about wildebeest and the origin of the word, it's from Dutch. Here we go. There are the two babies. And I think the wildebeest used to live in the Western Cape, where the first Dutch settlers went ashore. And I think it's possibly one of the first animals they saw. Because if you break up the word and translate it, a wildebeest, a wild cow. And there were definitely more wildebeest than buffalo in the Cape, so I think maybe that's one of the first animals the Europeans first ever saw. And oh, they're off on a run. And mom runs after. Roger, I must agree with you, wildebeest are absolutely wonderful. They're often called the clowns of the bushveld. They sort of have their silly 5 minutes where they snort and run around in circles chasing each other. Off it goes again. Look at him go. Oh, so cute. Having a silly 5 minutes, the little guys. So, Dara in Ohio, it seems like Ohio is very active, the Sunrise Safari. We'd like to know, do wildebeest rally together to defend the young against predators like buffalo? They do, for a lot of animals, but not against lions only, but I've seen them do it against wild dog, cheetah, and occasionally leopard as well. So chatting about lions and wildebeest. Is that three babies or two? Still just two? No. There's three. Can you just hear that? Soft. Oh, look at that. Like a lot of baby antelope species, all legs. Says, he thinks the lions are all feeding off baby impala, baby wildebeest, and no hurry to come back and visit us at Juma. I think Paul might be right. It does feel like I haven't seen lions in ages. On one of the baby wildebeest, you can still see the umbilical cord attached, and Elizabeth noticed it as well. Well done, Elizabeth. And sometimes pieces of umbilical cord can hang around for up to a week on antelope after they've been given birth. Sorry, not after the babies are given birth, obviously after they've been born. And now being stalked by a baby wildebeest. And if you sit with a herd long enough, sometimes the curiosity gets the better of them and they come to investigate the vehicle. So, just opposite us, there's a baby lying down. Just through the bush, and can you see it there? There we go. Having a snooze under mom. Oh, nap time's over. It's amazing, these little guys can run very fleet-footedly within about 15 minutes of being born. And you sort of have to when you live out here in the bush. Otherwise, your chances of being snacked upon by one of the predators is very high. So I'm just going to move forward a little bit. One of the strangest looking animals around. Oh, I nearly forgot. I got so distracted by babies that I'm going to ask you guys a question. And all it looks like next one's preparing to lie down, digging itself a nice little spot. Oh, there we go. Flop. And they'll probably rest in this area and ruminate from quite a bit of the morning while it's still cool. Yeah, it looks like they're all preparing to bed down for a while at least. But what is the original colonial collective noun for wildebeest? What is the original colonial collective noun for a group of wildebeest? And send your answers through to questions@wildearth.tv or use the hashtag SafariLive on Twitter. Oh, baby's going down. Everyone's going down, it seems. Nap time. So those in the front there, right next to the baby, are last year's baby. I mean, that's at a year old, and look how big they are already. But they seem very curious with the youngster, and all going to sleep next to it. Oh, nearly still on the baby as it's trying to sleep. Okay, well, let's leave the wildebeest. They're all going to bed down in this area. So, I'm going to leave the wildebeest having a nice snooze. Gonna go see what else we can find, and hopefully there's still a leopard in the pipeline. But while we continue on, let's go see what Jamie's been up to.
How amazing is this? 2 days ago I was here, and just after the rains, the pool started to fill up around the Arethusa Dam. The airstrip dam. And those white patches of foam that you're seeing at the moment, those come from frogs. Foam nest frogs, to be exact. And what they do is the male grasps the female, and she lays her eggs and he fertilizes them. Obviously all of this happens externally. And they whip their legs, they beat their legs together, and they actually make that foamy substance at the same time. So that is a whole collection of little tadpole eggs waiting to hatch. And when they do hatch, they'll drop down into this dam if, fingers crossed, if there's still water here. And it's a bit of a risk that female foam nest takes, because if this pan has dried up, her tadpoles will die. Some of them are incredibly high up as well, right underneath the buffalo weaver's nest. And that's probably about, what would that be, 5 meters, six, no more, probably about 7 meters in the air. That's a rude awakening if you're a tadpole. Imagine belly flopping from 7 meters up into the pan. Quite a way to start off your life. But if she's lucky, it will be a right place to have created her foam nest, and she'll be able to raise a successful brood. So she will have met up with the male by following his calls, and then she will have made that foam, and then she'll head off and she'll search for a different mate, and she'll repeat the whole process again and move from pan to pan in the hope. And any one of those nests can contain well over 1,000 eggs within it. It's a really useful way of essentially ensuring the survival of the species, because you can imagine how many threats there must be for little tadpoles out there. It's a difficult life. But really special to see. I wish I had my frog book, but I think Brent's got it. Maybe if you ask nicely, he'll show you a picture of a foam nest frog. But quite an interesting little frog. They're sort of greyish in color, but their skin color changes according to the temperature. So on really, really hot days, they go white almost. Very, very light gray to reflect that light away from them. And on cold days like today, then they become a bit grayer and a bit darker in color. And you find them in the strangest places. I've had foam nest frogs living in showers for days, for the entire season. It will just hang out in the shower, sort of curled up against the tap, or on clocks, or on hooks for tea towels. They love those funny little places. And they're quite useful as well in terms of keeping an eye out for snakes, because they will start to emit a very high-pitched squeal that will alert you to, and they're keeping an eye out all the time for that kind of threat. I was trying to keep an eye out for the dragonfly that was hanging around here, but I think it might have disappeared off. It's still got a nice lapwing though. The ever-present blacksmith lapwings. We seem to be doing a birding day today. Birds and frogs. Now, this water is fairly temporary. It's the first time that we've seen it as full as it is at the moment. And the foam nest frogs picked a good spot. And clay... Oh, there we go. There's dragonflies. Oh, no shame, Andrew. Trying to get Andrew to... I'm really making him work today. Trying to spot fast-moving dragonflies. Ah, they've disappeared off. I think they were chasing each other. They're very territorial creatures. Sorry, Andrew, making your life difficult. We've got this water here, which is a fantastic source of life for all kinds of creatures around it. And Clay was wondering if the frogs remember where the water is or whether they go out looking for it. And I think it is a combination of the two for frogs. They probably go out looking as well as remembering a little bit where they were hanging out in the same area where they knew they had access to water the previous year. For the rest of the animals, the bigger they get and the sort of more towards the bird and mammal side they get, then definitely they would remember where water is. And elephants, of course, are the most famous for that. Well done, Andrew. There's the dragonfly. That brief glimpse. Oh, we have some wonderful cameramen. Well done, Andrew. That brief glimpse was enough for us to chat a little bit about it. I think the dragonfly that we were looking at there as it zoomed over the water. Oh, found something else. Dung ball. It's all happening here at the airstrip dam. Hee, look at him go. So this lucky dung beetle has managed to snare a female, and he's doing all the work pushing her around while she clings onto the dung ball. Whoopsie daisy. Come on, you can do it. Up the hill. Oh, bit of a stroke. Nope, and back down again. Standing on the dung ball to get his bearings. And she actually serves quite an important purpose there, because on steep slopes, if he was pushing up against it, she serves as almost like a stopper on that dung ball. Whoopsie daisy. Oh, back where you started. So it's not just that she's being lazy and letting him do all the work. Come on, buddy. Oh, you can do it. He wants to go that way. He doesn't want to take the easy way out, this dung beetle. Oh, I think he did it. Hey, well done. Well done, buddy. Very interesting. Now they'll be on the mission to go and search for somewhere to dig down and hide that dung ball. They'll mate and she'll lay her eggs in there, and then the brood or the larval stage that hatches out of those eggs will then have a perfect food source in the form of dung. excuse me. So we have a question not quite related to our dung beetle, but still an interesting one, and one that I get asked fairly regularly. So Roy was wondering if there's any effect in terms of, or any difference in terms of your gender as a safari guide, maybe with something with tone, anything like that, in terms of animal encounters, handling animals. For the most part, no. I try not to speak in a high-pitched voice. I usually, especially when I'm talking to things like elephants, I try and keep that tone very low, but that applies to all of us. For the most part, I've never felt any kind of extra threat level because I'm a girl, in terms of maybe facing down a lion charge or an elephant charge. It's very much, they're focused on your bipedal form, so the human standing form, and that's what they see as the important aspect to it. Whether you're a man or a woman doesn't really play into it all that much, except, and there's a big exception to this, primates. So baboons and monkeys, and I suppose, although not naturally occurring here, but chimpanzees as well, there is a serious difference in the way that they view. They recognize man versus woman, and I've often noticed, especially trying to chase monkeys away from camps, they're much less likely to run away from me, or at least it takes a further degree of aggression from me to get them to move, whereas if a man walks out and shouts at them. And that's an interesting one. I think it's because they've got that slightly further or closer to human evolution path that they've taken, that they've got that recognition between male and female. They're also one of the animals, of course, with clearer color vision. So it's an interesting one. There's definitely a difference in the way that baboons and monkeys respond to me. And I know that's something that the ladies in FC have experienced in the past, with monkeys making a surprise appearance at the door. Relocate our dung beetle. Got him.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, there he is. Can you get him from there, or is he too close?
No,
there, there. Just to. Oh yeah, I think he started to dig, or he just got trapped under his own dung ball. It's also nope. He's still going. No, he's still going. And Sweet Ums was wondering how. See Daisy. Better be careful, buddy. You're getting close to the water's edge. That could end badly. Sweet on Twitter was wondering how far he may have pushed that dung ball from or for. I honestly have no idea, but they can go for kilometers at a time if they're really dedicated. How he decides where it is he's going to go is an interesting one, and one that a question that I don't think we really know the answer to. I think he's chosen a very silly path, though. He's about to hit the erosion patch of the water, and that could end not so well for him. He keeps jumping up onto the top of the dung ball to try and see where he's, whoops, he's bouncing, where he's going. Oh dude, you didn't take the easiest path, did you? It must be hard when you're that tiny. Oh no, now he's gonna try and get it back up. Oh dear. There's a lot of general game species around the airstrip where he might have collected his dung. Generally, these larger species tend to favour the dung of larger animals. Oh dear. Oopsie. Oopsie. I think it looks like they might start to dig. I think they've decided that they've found the perfect spot. It might even have come from this wildebeest, the dung pile. There's plenty of wildebeest dung around here. This wildebeest at this airstrip is a little bit crazy. I don't know whether you've noticed, Andrew. I've seen him a few times.
He's running.
And he just seems to run. He does it all the time. Mm. It's like he's running laps. Maybe he's training for something. Because whenever I come to this airstrip, there's a wildebeest running around. Around and around, up and down, for no conceivable reason. Egyptian geese flapping away. Andrew's been doing a fan. Oh, they're all going now. Very territorial creatures. It's like our wildebeest friend, who apparently is practicing for the Great Migration all on his own. I know, Anna Marie, you were wondering if South African wildebeest migrate in the same way that they do in sort of Eastern and Central Africa. And the answer is no, they don't. And not only because they don't need to, in terms of the security of resources, but also because they can't, unfortunately. It's something that South Africa is really looking towards developing, which is the migration corridors and creating passages where animals can move through uninhibited by roads and fences. But it's something that's going to... There he goes again. He's a lunatic. What's up, boy? He's not running from us. I mean, these wildebeest, especially around the airstrip, are very habituated to people. Maybe he's just got places to be. Or in his heart, he feels like he should be one of the migrating wildebeest. Bye, boy. I would try and catch up with him, but I think he's got quite a significant head start. Let's see if we can get closer and find out what's happening in his life. I don't think that he's running from us. He should be fairly comfortable with our presence. He's still on the move, but you were with Brent in that wonderful wildebeest herd, and Jeffrey, who's watching in Texas, was wondering if wildebeest are easily habituated and whether people ever have them as pets. The only example I know of that was a wildebeest that I knew was orphaned, and a friend of mine tried to hand raise it. And it was a hugely difficult process, because once that wildebeest was a female, once that wildebeest reached sexual maturity, it became incredibly possessive over him to the point that it started attacking his girlfriend. And it's quite a, it's actually quite a strange and common story that you get with trying to keep, not necessarily keep wild animals as pets, but having them around you in that kind of context, especially herd animals like wildebeest. So although people do, they are easy to habituate to cars and to people, you probably get to the point where approaching them on foot is fairly easy. And, oh my word, dung beetles everywhere. I'm pretty sure that's where the dung beetle started, is where we are now. But not as something that should be kept as a sort of a garden pet. You could definitely keep them on a reserve and habituate them and get close to them. This particular instance, though, this guy is keeping a very close eye on us. Now, wildebeest are interesting creatures because they don't have a harem. The one we're looking at is a male. Well, we were looking at. The one we were looking at is a male. So they will keep hold of a territory and defend it, and there'll be competition for the best spot. So access to water, the best grazing potential, and that's their way or their approach to attracting the ladies. What's up, buddy? What's got you so nervous? But Ask Me was wondering how many females a male will impregnate during their lifetime. And I have to be honest, in that respect, I have no idea. Because they defend the territories like they do, they have to wait for the females to sort of come through, and they'll mate with them then, and try and keep them within their territory, which is what's happening with that wildebeest herd around Juma at the moment. But I honestly have no idea. I think it's a brilliant question. But I don't know the answer. One male will be responsible for most of those pregnant females, since they breed at exactly the same time in that area. Sure, very good question, and one I'm afraid I don't know the answer to. I would be lying if I said I did. And as our crazy wildebeest disappears off, I believe that Brent has found some pachyderms for you, so let's head back across to him.
Unfortunately, as we found these elephants, they've started moving into a very thick patch of bush, and they're on a mission. Where they're going, only they know. But they're almost ignoring us, but they are walking with purpose at the moment. So try to get to a spot where we can possibly see them up ahead. But, oh, there's a nice young bull. But they are disappearing into a very, very thick block. Near impossible for us to keep up with them through there. There's a nice bull. He's going to have big tusks one day. You can see how long they are already. And he's probably early 20s and already showing a fine set of ivory. Not very thick yet, but nice and long. Actually sounds like there could be more elephants up ahead as well. There goes the last of the herd disappearing into the thickets. Like grey ghosts moving through the bush. Oh, those two young bulls are having a little go. Get a bit more of a view. Oh, no, they've stopped now. So, fortunately for us, they're going down a little, what we call a two-track. So we'll try to stick with them for a bit longer. Noreen is in the Great Lake District in Michigan. Nice. Now, is it true that if elephants are scared of bees? I don't know if I'd go with scared, but definitely wary of. And let's see if we can get a nice shot of this bull from the other side of the termite mound. Here we go. And here he is. Noreen, probably wary. I mean, there's a really interesting project that's going on in Kenya at the moment where they're using beehives on poles around crops to try to bring down the amount of conflict between humans and elephants, so to stop elephants crop raiding, and it seems to be working quite well at the moment. And I know an elephant researcher who's played bee noises at Ellie's and watched them move away. Imagine if they pushed down a tree with a beehive in it, they must get absolutely attacked. Okay, let's see if we can catch up with the rest of the herd. And while we do that, we've got quite an interesting idea here from James Doherty in Indiana. We like that, with I think science should bring back the woolly mammoth. James, I personally don't. I mean, they went extinct for a reason. So I don't see any scientific or decent reason to bring back the woolly mammoth. The only reason I can think of is possibly human interest. But I don't know how well they would survive in today's current climate. And that's why they went extinct. And also, they went extinct at about the same time as things like cave lions, and that's all about 10,000 years ago. Ooh, someone's found a bird. Or... that's the wonderful thing about this time of the year. Almost every little mud wallow that's got water in it, the Ellie's are nearby. They'll take the opportunity to play a bit. But it's quite cool this morning, so not too vigorously. and unfortunately they're moving into a very thick area and we're not going to be able to keep up with them. Off they go. So while we move along, Sydney, welcome to Ian from New Jersey. We'd like to know, do dung beetles prefer dung from herbivores or carnivores? Well, Sydney, they're actually dung beetles that prefer herbivore dung, and the dung beetles that prefer carnivore dung. So they are species specific to those different types of dung. So the answer to is they prefer both depending on what type of dung beetle they are. So you always got to be careful when driving past branches at this time of the year. This one's not wet, but see if an elephant's been mud wallowing, it's a walks past the branch and you can see how caked in mud it is, and if you're not careful you can be caked in mud from a tree. I mean, just look at this one. I'm just going to squeeze forward a bit. Look how thick the mud's encased on these leaves, and this is not from today. As you can see, it's very dry. It crumbles off, but one must be careful not to become pasted in mud at this time of the year when driving, or at any time of the year actually, when driving around areas where elephants have access to mud. And those of you been watching for, if you have a look on the bonnet here, that's where Brian and I nearly got sprayed by elephant mud wiping. You can just see the brown spots on the bonnet there, and that's mud from an elephant spray. Just left those eddies. We got a question from Australia, or South Australia, from Chris, who would like to know what makes a male elephant more attractive to females. Is it his size or his tusks? Chris, generally it'll be the size, and there's more competition between the males and females actually choosing. As the males are so big, if a female's an estrus, it'll be ever the dominant, biggest, most aggressive male in that area is will be the one who will earn the mating rights. So while we continue on, let's go see what Jamie's got.
To continue with our birding warning, we've got another fairly, probably new to a lot of new viewers, a Birchall's Cuckoo. We've actually got a pair of them, which explained our whooping sound. They're desperately balancing on the top bits of the guari bushes, which are barely supporting their weight, particularly in the wind, bobbing up and down, desperately trying to stay on. There's the second one, positioned very inconveniently in front of the tanker, the big white thing you can see there. Look at him! Bobbing about. I'd get motion sick if that were me. The Birchall's Cuckoo, also known as the rain bird. The reason for that is that their breeding season coincides perfectly with the rainy season. And their call, which is sounds a little bit like bubbles, it's a sort of a coo-coo-coo-coo-coo-coo-coo. Sound is often associated, and local people believe that their call brings the rain. So hopefully they whoopsie. Woo! Anyway, head first off there. Hopefully they'll call and bring us some rain. But really it's just because their breeding season is typically around this time of year, which is the start of the rainy season. But not a bird that we often get to see, and certainly not as out in the open as this one is. They tend to prefer thick vegetation. Now this is a permanent species, but we hardly ever see them during the winter. But James Taylor, you were wondering if any of our local species migrate to different places, and absolutely they do. The wonderful thing about this time of year is that we're getting almost all of them back again, because it is summer and the rainy season and food is bountiful. But for example, that European roller that Brent had this morning is the first one of the season, the first European roller, and as its name suggests, comes all the way down from Europe. But we get all kinds of things, from the cuckoos, the woodlands kingfishers, even things like steppe eagles and steppe buzzards come all the way from Russia. So we've got lots and lots of bird species that come and go throughout the year, but this is the best time to go birding in South Africa. But on a slightly different subject, I think that Brent might have relocated his animals for you, so let's head back across to him.
Well, we've met up with an old friend. The baby elephant closest to us is Mr. Wrinkly Bottom, and that female with the nice long tusks up ahead is his mom. And see, he's grown quite a bit since we last had a good sighting of him. Moment, I can't really go closer. I'm literally surrounded 100% by elephants to every side of me. So they hopefully are moving towards the pan, so I'm just rolling very slowly. But Ellie is too big, two young Ellie balls behind us. Some more elephants coming through the drainage line and all the Ellie's on the road in front of us. A lovely afternoon, morning traffic jam. And we'll try to get a proper view of Mr. Wrinkly Bottom, who's definitely grown a lot. Right in the center of the herd, and look, this is going to be quite fun. As soon as they hit a hill, that huge body size seems to speed them up. Look at that. Oop-a-dump-a-dump. Sheer weight. They always look so funny when they go down hills. So they start speeding up slowly. And then whoop, 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 boom, 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 boom. Looks like they're in a hurry. In a hurry, they can't help. So there's a pan on the other side, and I'm hoping they might be going there for a bit of splishing and splashing. And then up the other side, at half the speed, slow down even more. Engage low range and four-wheel drive to take those huge bodies up the hills. Oh dear, and we've got a speeding elephant coming up our rear. Oh, we've managed to slow down. It's a young bull, he's only got one tusk. And he's decided to have a snack on the way down. There he is, directly behind us. Liam is doing some serious acrobatics to get you that shot. And let's move on through now that the road ahead of us is cleared. We're just moving through with the herd, you know, as one does. I'm going to try to get round now. Some of them have gone off on this elephant path there. See if we can get a view of Mr. Wrinkly Bottom. Oh, yep, he's still there. He is. That one there. I think they're going to go to the pan. You can see his mom's is very nice long straight tusks, that female there. I'm just gonna get ahead of them to get to the pan. Oh, give a quick view. There he is. Hello, Horror. seems too cool for school these days. Not as interested as he once was. Yes, too cool for school. Yeah, I think they might go play in the mud, so I'm just going to shoot ahead with me. Beware, I can just see terrapins moving. There's lots of trouble coming your way. So the name... Oof! Grumpiness. So the name of this pan is Chele Pan, which basically means frog pan. So, wrinkly bottoms on the left there. Next to a slightly older little lady. Sorry, on the right. If we come across. We'll show you him now, but look how cute those two are. I mean, look at this little female closest to us. Here. Just going on her tusks there for me. Look at that, she almost has forest elephant-shaped tusks. See how they're facing almost down, as opposed to upwards, which is a general forest elephant sort of sign, but she's definitely not there. There's wrinkly bottom behind her, but you can see that very distinct wrinkled skin on his bum. There we go. Isn't this incredible to be able to sit with these huge animals and have them completely relaxed around us? Look at this. There's Wrinkly Bonnet's mom having a sniff, checking the air. I mean, we are probably going to be engulfed by elephants shortly. So we've got all of these. Oh, Wrinkly Bottom's on the stalk. Is he going to do his normal shenanigans? Come on. Oh, a little one. That's not Wrinkly Bottom, I apologize. There are too many baby elephants. Wrinkly Bottom's there. Now, isn't this incredible? Right next to me. I mean, less than 4 foot away is this female elephant eating a little baby leadwood. And literally, we can't move now. We've got elephants behind us, in front of us. I was hoping for a little bit more playing in the pan, but it seems like they have a schedule to keep. They're on the move. And Vim is being stalked by a little male elephant. Look at him. He has a good sniff. There's one of those young bulls hanging on the periphery. So wait for the female and this little elephant to move, and then we'll move to catch up with the rest of the herd again. Look. Okay. Wait, nearly gone past us. You can see them slowly moving down the elephant path. Good morrow to Mike in sunny Florida. He'd like to know, do we think there'd ever be a chance for Mike to apply for a job at Wild Earth one day? Well, Mike, there's always a chance. In fact, I don't know what you do, so difficult for me to say. But I would say always a chance and never give up. Okay. You know how long I have elephants behind us so we can move. Oh, next bunch of elephants behind us. They're a bit further away. Sorry. One little drive over a stump and that one got a fright. All's fine now. Hello, little boy. He's probably broken his left-hand tusk, either play-fighting or on a tree. It's not that uncommon to see elephants with one tusk. Jeez, everywhere we look, more elephants and more elephants just peppering up. Really enjoying all the water and puddles around at the moment, the ellies. Hello, little boy. You can see now that there's a lot of water around, they're far more leisurely with their drinking. And before, when there was almost no water, they would get in, drink, get out, having to travel between where they can feed and where the water was. I know you guys saw a flock of wattle starlings with Jamie earlier. They are everywhere. I've seen about five flocks there. One just flew over us right now. Like kids at a diner with a big cool drink. Slurpy, slurpy, slurp. Well, let's go catch up with the rest of the herd. Oh, maybe, hello. No. There's that young bull. Right, normally on the edges, they cause a bit of trouble with the rest of them. Let's let them go past, and then we're going to go try catch up with Mr. Inky Bottom and his mom. Female going next. So it looks like the Ellie herd is now spreading out to feed. So it seems like everyone out there is really enjoying this Ellie sighting. Me too. And so nice to catch up with Mr. Wrinkly Bottom again. But it is incredible to just spend some time with these wonderful animals. a very big congratulations to Shannon, Joel, and Deb, who got the original collective noun for a wildebeest. It's quite a funny one, and it comes from... to you too, madam. Comes from East Africa, and it is an implausibility of wildebeest, and I'm quite sure that's named after the migration. And while we were with these elephants, especially since we saw them marching down the road earlier, I'm going to tell you the original collective noun for elephants, which was a parade. And a parade of elephants, all the little ones chasing each other. We'll try and catch up. Fun and games between the little boys. Sprinkly Bond's mother shaking her head at us, just reminding us that she's big and strong and we shouldn't cause any trouble, and don't worry, madam, we won't. And there's Wrinkly Bottom to the right of her. Leg. So from a big grey blob to a tiny grey blob with Jamie.
Luckily, very relaxed and not running away, grey blobs, over here. We're just checking in with our newly favourite warthog family, largely because they're really nice and relaxed around vehicles, and they let us watch them for a while. Everybody's on their ankles, doing some deep root foraging here. I love the little babies at this age, when they've just got those tiny pieces of tusks starting to poke through. And that ridge of hair on the top, just to help make them look big and scary if they need to. It's a mother and four babies. Now, I'm pretty sure that there used to be another mother as well, but I haven't seen her this morning. And they must have a burrow somewhere very close to here. This is about the fifth or sixth time that I've seen them foraging right in this area. They're really making the most of the new grass shoots and the new growth points that are starting to come through after the rain. And it's not just their teeth, for the most part, in fact, it's not their teeth that are doing the sort of biting work to get the grass off. Their lips are actually very tough and very muscular as a way of sort of shearing and tearing away at the grass shoots. Much in the same way that hippos do, actually. Now, the warthog the other day was actually one of the winning animals in terms of Brent and my competition. And Alice, and I'm sure many others, were wondering how he handled his loss. Hello, warthog. For those of you who missed it, Brent challenged me to a competition to see who could find the most mammals, and I promptly won. He handled it in much the way that we expected him to, which was to then tell me how he could have beaten me in a bird or insect or flower quiz, at which point I told him he was getting a bit predictable because I'd already said that to the viewers. But otherwise, he handled it absolutely fine. He still hasn't cooked me dinner, but we'll just have to wait for the appropriate moment when he has a chance to. I'll remind him of that promise, don't worry. I will remind him. that the warthog was one of the lucky winning animals. That's the one that really put us ahead as we raced around Juba trying to find all of the mammal species around us. Somehow neither of us managed to find a buffalo though, which is completely ridiculous. The place is full of buffalo. And what a happy little foraging family this is. Mandy, we're sitting looking at one of the most wonderful herbivores, in my opinion, that we get out here. But Mandy Olson was wondering, are there more herbivores or carnivores out here in Africa? And by necessity, as in pretty much everywhere, the carnivores will be outnumbered quite seriously by the herbivores, just to make sure that the species are all in a balance. And generally what you'll find is the population of carnivores and the way that that population grows is directly related to the population of the herbivores, but a couple of steps behind. So if, for example, in the dry season the population of herbivores drops because they're being killed off and struggling with thirst and nutrition, then the population of carnivores will increase for a while because they have constant access to food, but then will start to drop off because the food access is slowly decreasing. So there's a unique connection there. Now those are tiny herbivores that we've been looking at, and I believe that Brent still has his big herbivores to watch, so let's head back across to them.
So the edges have slowly spread out and are moving, and we're trying to keep with the herd as they head on the edge of a drainage line. There's a nice big female in front of us now, and we're not going to chase them into the thickets. We'll stay with them while they're out in the open. But lots of ellies everywhere. Sorry about my head being in the way there. Oh, this is absolutely stunning. And spend hours and hours with ellies. And they're always up to something. Virginia, who's in Kentucky, says the ellies seem to have filled out some since a few weeks ago. Are they getting some more nourishing foods? I would say they are, Virginia. They're getting a bit more grass now. But I would say I can't really see too much of a difference myself. The one thing I have noticed is the mammary glands on the females that are lactating are definitely looking a lot more full and a lot more healthy. So the mothers are definitely getting better food and it's providing better milk for the youngsters. You can see this big female there, her mammary glands are quite nice and swollen. So an elephant's trunk is an incredible appendage. I mean, it's able to pick up things, able to suck things in. And Wendy, is wondering how much water can the trunk hold. Well, Wendy, if I remember correctly, it's about 8 liters or 9 liters, which is about 2 gallons. And one of an elephant's favorite foods, this one that we're looking at now, is on, which is baby Ledwards. But that one is not after the Ledward, it's after the grass that's growing below the Ledward. And so, as we said a bit earlier, I mean, if they have a choice, grass has got far more nutrients and it's much easier to chew and digest. So when there's grass around, they will, but he decided not to. Thought he was going to break off a little bit of that Ledward. He wrapped his trunk around it. So during the summer months when the grass is available, the ellies will eat that. But in the winter months, most of their diet is made up of leaves and trees. It's not to say that they won't eat trees and leaves at this time of the year, and we've only had a little bit of rain, so they still, the majority of their meals at the moment are still mostly trees. Hello, little man. Here we have it. He's a teenager. I guess to be probably between 15 and, well, I still say younger than 20, so 15 and 18 maybe. What's he eating there? It looks like he's eating a little bit of a spike thorn. Not really keen on eating it, but just sort of playing with it. So the Ellie's are moving off into a thicket in Skibbew. And we've had such an incredible sighting, there's no need to go bashing and crashing after them. And how wonderful to catch up with Mr. Wrinkly Bottom again. Well, he seems a bit too cool to play with us these days, but that could change. Maybe he's just in a mood to spend his playing days with other Ellie's. But we're gonna move on now, see what else we can find, and let the Ellie's enjoy their trip down the drainage line. One young Ellie bull who's had one time. So Lenny's wondering, oh, it was a European roller, but it took off and left two hornbills in its place. Oh yeah, yellow-billed hornbills. Quite often referred to as flying bananas, a big yellow bill. But Lenny, sorry about that, back to your question. It was about elephant tusks in their back and their brakes. So sometimes they will break beyond what is visible to us, but inside the actual, very seldom will they break at the root. And there's a good third of an time.
Oops, and it seems as though Brent has disappeared. I had some male impalas trying to spar just before you came across onto this vehicle. I was hoping they were going to continue, but true to live wildlife filming, they decided to A, stop, and B, hide behind the trees. The group at the back there are sparring, but right at the back. Oh, gentlemen, how very unobliging of you. Luckily, we also have some surprise kudu to show you. You should be able to see both the impala and the kudu. Doing what animals very often do in this weather. Windy, slightly cold. So they lie down, shelter and ruminate. That's actually quite a beautiful, peaceful scene there. Four female kudu. Lying down and ruminating on both balls of cud and presumably life as well. Oh, go ahead across to Brent. Let's see what he's got.
Look at this, guys. It's a bush baby during the day. So rare to see them even at night and get a good visual. But look at that. What are you doing up? So normally, oh, jumps off. They're in nests, in hollows in trees. Still there. You go forward a bit. So it's wonder if possibly their nest hasn't been... Got him on the, over the termite mound there, yeah? Okay, so go up. There we go, over to the right. So it's possible a snake or something might have chased them out of the nest, and I'm guessing the nest would be in probably either this, we'll show you now, a big marilla or a dead leadwood around. But how unusual is this? Gone. I think we can get another visual. But how incredible is that? And an incredible spot by the wildebeest. Vim says, what's that? Is that a bush baby during the day? And I thought he'd seen a squirrel. It's a bit skeptical, but Vim was spot on there. And he spotted that little South African galago, or lesser bush baby. Now, they're quite fascinating little critters. We only get two species, the thick-tailed and the South African in this area, but in other parts of Africa you have multiple species, and the way to tell the difference between them shape and penis. One even has one that is shaped like a corkscrew, like a bottle opener. So very, very interesting. And I've met a few people who spend their life studying bush baby penises, and they look identical. It's only once they get down to that fine detail they're able to tell the difference. But guys, it's been so wonderful having you on the Sunrise Safari. Incredible Ellie sightings. Unfortunately, the cats are still making themselves scarce, but we will try our best to hopefully bring you one on the Sunset Safari. But we're going to carry on and start heading home for our breakfast, and we're going to send you off to Jamie. We're in a bit of a funny signal area, it seems, so she'll say goodbye to you. So from Vera and myself, toodaloo.
And the cats have been playing games with us all morning, but still been a fantastic day of all kinds of fascinating things. I was hoping that these male impala would continue their sparring session, but they've decided not to. Seen some really fascinating stuff, a couple of new birds for quite a few of you, I'm sure, as well as that incredible colored nyala, which I have never ever seen before. I thought it was absolutely awesome and really interesting to see that bright, pale, almost yellow color that I've never seen before. Really totally fascinating to see. And thank you all for your brilliant questions. It is so wonderful to have such a great group of viewers, as well as so many new people jumping on board with us. And I really, really hope that you will stick around with us. And a big thank you to Andrew for keeping up with all of the crazy bird sightings that we've had, as well as to Nikki and Kirst for their fantastic directing work in FC. We've got a pretty exciting afternoon planned because it's still cloudy and cold. The cats are going to be moving at odd times of the day, and we just never know what we are going to find around the next corner. So don't forget to join us for the Sunset Safari. Have a wonderful day wherever you are in the world, or evening, and we will catch up with you a little bit later. Bye-bye for now.